Yo guys, welcome to RenderRam. My name is Vieco and today we'll talk about camera exposure in ArcVis and why it will save you a lot of time with your scene setups. I've seen artists complaining many times about loading this cool wood texture and it would look too bright or too dark in their scenes, so they would always need to lighten or darken that texture for it to fit just right. I'm gonna show you the simple but effective tactic that I use in all of my projects with two examples where I'll cover daylight scene and the night scene. Keep in mind that this technique works for all 3D softwares and rendering engines. For our first example, we have a room, one window, and one light, which is sun, from the outside. You can see these nice little sun rays hitting these areas of the room. Now, whenever you need to do your exposure, you always need to know which area of the image is most important to you. I know in ArcVis, many times you want everything to be important and that everything is perfectly lit, but the truth is, your image needs to have a story. It needs to have an order how things are gonna be looked at. So for example, if you make your scene so that this thing pops out, this thing pops out, this pops out, this pops out, whenever a viewer is gonna see that, he won't know where to look first, and that's a bad sign. So for this image, I have chosen this unit to be my main hero of the image. So we're gonna make our exposure based on this unit. So obviously this image is a little bit underexposed, but how do we know where is that sweet spot? I mean, we have our exposure section here. We can go up and down, but when do we know where to stop? So I have one trick that I use on how to define my perfect exposure. So since I chose this unit here to be my main hero of the story, I'm gonna base my whole exposure based on this part. Because this is kind of, you know, the middle. Now, watch carefully, I'm not aiming it based on the sunlight part. So I'm ignoring the sunlight. I'm counting that the sunlight will be overexposed, which is okay because usually direct sunlight is like that. Unless you wanna create an image where your main focus is on the actual sunlight, but my technique works for that also. So the way I do this, I select my complete scene, I apply a gray material to it. Now, when it comes to materials, there's one thing that you need to define for yourself, and that is the maximum white color of your textures and of your materials. So for example, if we look colors in nature, you have various degrees of white color. So the wall has one white color, paper is a different white color, it's not the same white color, snow is a different white color, but technically on an RGB scale like here, wall or a paper is roughly around 220, and this is the measure that I'm gonna be using. When it comes to snow, for example, fresh snow has an RGB value of 235, and in reality that 235 is considered to be border self-emissive, so it's literally almost glowing. With that said, I keep all my materials to a maximum of 220. I'm not encouraging you to start using 220. Some people use 186, some people use 200, some people use 210. It's just a personal preference. Since 220 is my maximum white color that I'm gonna be using, and now, since everything here has a material of 220, let me right click. Sorry, my red circle is right on the RGB. I hope you see it. Anyhow, but you see that my RGB value is 188, 190, 190. So, and when I click on my material, you can see that my maximum white color on my material is 220, and in reality, in my render, it's 188. So let's pump that exposure a little bit up. The point is, you want to increase your exposure so that your main hero part of the image gets to that 220 level. Let's say 1.4. So 1.4, when I click here, it's 205, 206. It doesn't need to be precisely 220. It can be off by 3, 4, 5 units. So let's try 106. So 106, we are at 212. Okay, let's go to 1.8. So 1.8 is... Okay, so we're roughly there. Like I said, we don't need to be exact to be on 220. So this is just fine. Now, let's put back all my materials and see how this scene looks. Now, while this is rendering, keep in mind that usually in a high-end post-production, this technique is used with the gray material. So they would be using this middle section here, something like this. But the reason I'm using a white material is in high-end post-production, you're not tone mapping. I mean, you are, but to a degree. But you don't use burn values or contrasts and stuff like that, because all of that is added in post. Not to mention LUT, all the LUTs. The main thing is, since we are bending the image here with contrasts, burn value, gammas, LUTs, etc., the color curve is not linear anymore, and it's curved from that point. And because of that, I'm using the white color as a peak color as a technique for this. So, okay, here's our scene now. And, okay, it's looking pretty lit. So, let's see where we were before and where we at now. So, before, we were sitting at number one. And yeah, number one definitely looks bad and underexposed, etc. But now when we're at 1.8, it looks really nice. Everything is well lit. You can easily see everything. Now let's see if this whole thing really makes sense. So let me go to my material here. So let's say this peach colored material. So when I click on my color here, okay, the color is pretty similar. Yeah, the color is a little bit yellowish, reddish. But this is not the point of the video. The point of the video is the light value, not the color. So for example, we can see that our color here is at the maximum light value of 193. So when I right click here, you can see that I'm really sitting at 194. You can see the left value, the highest value in the RGB from those three. We are sitting at 194.93, so that means that this texture is displayed correctly in this whole room setup. Now, if I drop a wood texture or a marble texture to this material, let's see how that one will behave. So, if I drop this wood texture, I'm not gonna set up the wood material, I'm just gonna use this for demonstration. You can see that this wood behaves really nicely. And the lightness is on point to the original texture. Let's try with a dark marble texture. Now notice that this texture has a lot of dark gray, light gray, and all those slight tones that might get eaten with an incorrect exposure. So when I turn this one in, you can see that all the tones are nicely visible. Blacks are not too black. Bright colors are not overly bright. They're just right. Everything just looks the way it should look. Let's go back to the wood material, and I'm gonna apply that wood material on my floor. Still, everything looks nice, the floor is well lit. If in some cases you have still some parts that are too dark and you don't like them, that's not an exposure issue anymore. That's your light issue. From that point, you need to tweak your light. Let's move on to the next example, and that is the night scene. So for our night scene, we're going to be using the same technique as shown in the previous example, but we will have to do some light manipulation because we are dealing with more than one light source. So let's turn on all the lights. Okay, from first glance, yeah, it looks like a night scene, but let's check with the good old white color checker to see where we are at exposure wise. So I'm gonna add my 220 RGB material or 220 value material to my scene. So let's see where we stand. So I'm actually gonna pick this part now because this part has a direct light from the ceiling light. It's not gonna be this anymore. So we are sitting at 170, 160 something. So let's crank that up. Let's go to 1.5. We're aiming for 220 again. Okay, so now we are at 200. Let's go 1.6. 203. Let's go 1.8. Okay, we're getting there. So, 2, I guess. We're close. So we're at 116, 117. We can go to 2.1. And I think that should do it. Yeah, we are sitting around 220. Now let's see what happens with our scene. Okay, this looks much better. You can tell that everything is lit nicely, but we do have a few lights that are unused properly. So for example, this light here. Now, since this is our, so this lighting is our pivot for everything at this point, let's kind of decrease this light a little bit. So let's try with a value of maybe from 15, I lowered it to 7. It could go more. Let's try 4. Now this looks really nice. I do have one issue with this, and that is, you know, when I'm looking at the whole image, like, this part is really bright, everything is cool, but we have this part here that's really bright also, and it kind of draws attention to this. So for this scene, I'm gonna do a little bit of an artistic approach. So let me just lower my backlights in my room. Now this looks much better. Now there is still one more light that we need to tweak. Usually when I have a light setup like this, I like all my lights to be feelable. So, and the last light I want to tweak is the outside. So since we have our exposure defined here, our lights are all defined, let's turn them all off and see how much of the effect does the outside give. Okay, so I'm going to increase my outside light a little bit. So let's go to from 1 to 1.6. Okay. We are kind of seeing the glimpses of blue light here. No, this is all fine. So let me just turn on my lights again. No, this feels really nice. The only thing I'm going to double check for the end is, so let's see, my color here, my value of my peach color here is 193. So let me see if we're there, because we were messing with some lights in the meantime and a lot of things changed, although it doesn't seem so. Okay, you see we're at 175 and our highest value here is 193. So let me crank up that light just a tiny bit. Something like this. Okay, we're near the value. I don't want my floor to be overexposed a little bit, so we're gonna leave it here. And that's it for today, guys. I hope you learned something new in this video. Keep your exposures right and make your textures happy. See you in the next video. Bye.